So my name is Laura Smith. I'm the volunteer and wellness coordinator for the City of St. Louis Park. And so I help recruit volunteers for all city departments. And then I manage some internal and external wellness programming. I'm going to be introducing all of the speakers today. First up, we have Meg McMonigal. She is the City of St. Louis Park Planning and Zoning Supervisor. Meg manages and directs all activities in the area of planning and zoning. She is responsible for the balance and prioritization of long and short range planning, as well as budgeted planning strategies into the future. She also serves as a project manager on major projects in the Community Development Department and is responsible for providing day-to-day work direction and supervision for the Planning and Zoning Division staff. Meg is currently very busy working on the Southwest Light Rail Transit Project. Please welcome Meg.
Thank you. I hope I can see. I gotta stand here to switch my slides, but I am here today to talk about light rail transit and just talk about what we're doing with it in St. Louis Park. It's a broad overview. So we'll begin with Southwest LRT is also called the Green Line Extension, and it runs from Target Field up to Eden Prairie. In St. Louis Park, there are three stations planned: Beltline, Wooddale, and Louisiana. And I'll show you a little bit about what we're working on related to those.
So the Green Line Extension is part of a metro-wide system that is being built of light rail and bus rapid transit, or BRT. And you can see on the map here that I point to Southwest LRT. Again, it's going out to the southwest part of the metro area from Target Field. So right now we're looking at opening day of 2020, and there's a number of things that are being done to get ready for that. We've been working on it for probably at least 15 years. It takes a long time to go through all the environmental review and all the engineering required. And I wanted to talk a little bit, since we're at an organic living workshop, about the impacts of transit on our day-to-day lives and on the environment. And this slide shows that a lot of us use our personal automobile quite a lot, and it can have a dramatic effect on greenhouse gas if we use transit instead. And this slide shows that we can have 62% less greenhouse gas emissions if we ride LRT instead of using a car. And there's quite a bit of CO2 saved, and as well as 99% less carbon monoxide and hydrocarbon emission per mile when riding LRT instead of using a car. So that's one of the reasons we really want transit, is that it's much better for our environment, less cars, less congestion. A lot of congestion on the roads means cars are stopped, emitting worse and worse and more emissions. So it's also good for our health. People tend to walk more if they're taking transit. You know, if you work downtown and you get off and you have to walk six blocks each way, then suddenly you have a mile under your belt without even realizing it. So just to talk a bit about the stations in St. Louis Park, we'll start west to east. Louisiana, at Louisiana Avenue, there will be a station. And it will be, if folks can picture where the regional trail and freight rail are near the hospital, just north of the hospital, it will be in that corridor. And when it crosses Louisiana on a bridge, it will come down to the grade of Oxford Street, and there will be a station there. And then at this station, there will be some parking, and there will be a new trail underpass that goes under the freight rail and regional trail to connect to the regional trail. So to get from the regional trail from this area, you will not have to cross railroad tracks. People are very interested in the trails and using them. So there will be a new freight rail bridge built that connects this east-west line to the south, as they will no longer be able to switch as they have in the past. They had a complicated switching system, or they do now, and it's very disruptive and it's noisy to surrounding residents, so that's a good thing that's going to go away. And then we are looking at another trail in this area from the Louisiana station over toward the Wooddale station that would be on the south side. So it's a bit of a redundant trail because the regional trail is on the north side and this will be on the south side. But again, it's to provide more access for our residents to the trail and to the rail stations. We've had a lot of change in the Louisiana area, the new interchange at Louisiana and 7, the shops at Knollwood did a renovation, and the hospital has done several expansions. Most recently, a $140 million expansion. So one of the things we're working on is trying to get all the employees at the hospital, not all of them probably, but we would like to get them to use the rail transit and get out of the car since it's so close. So then at the Wooddale station here, a couple images of what it might look like. And it's depicted in the lower picture where Nash Frame is, just for reference. That site is likely to be redeveloped. And what you can see here is the platform and the train, and then here is an underpass of the trail going under Wooddale Avenue. That's been a difficult crossing for bikers and walkers, so it's an important thing to the community. So that is part of the project now, and it's being funded largely by Hennepin County and Three Rivers Park District. So really good thing for us. It's shown here in red, and you will actually be able to exit as well to Wooddale, but we're trying to avoid pedestrians and bikes from crossing at this busy area. We have a lot of new development going on in the Wooddale area as well. We've had about 927 new housing units in this area, and the idea is if you have housing and workplaces and retail near transit stations, again, people can live and work without a car, and that's really what we're trying to aim for, to get more cars off the road. We're working with a developer on the former McGarvey Coffee property, and to do a sustainable development. They want to do an anaerobic digester, which would take the garbage from the community and turn it into energy for this new development. They're looking at a mix of housing types, affordable and market rate, some small commercial. They want to be super bike friendly and they want to do car sharing and anything else they can do to make it a super sustainable development. And then over to the Beltline station area, one important thing again is the regional trail crossing has been problematic. So there will be a trail bridge that goes over the roadway in this area, and it will continue over the light rail and freight rail tracks and land on the other side that it will connect with the Midtown Greenway. We're also looking at a number of improvements, new roadways and intersection improvements that will help all the circulation in the area. And those improvements are really stressing pedestrian and bike access. We would really like less people to drive to the stations too. So you could have you can take your bike on the train. We want to make it super easy. We want to make that the easiest way for people to get, especially if we're in a close area, to get to the station and use the transit. This is an aerial picture with that bridge I just talked about, with downtown Minneapolis in the background, and the star is about where the station platform will be. It was taken in the winter, as you can see. And we've had, again, what we call transit-oriented development. It's development that where people can live and work and very easily use the light rail. And maybe instead of being a two-car family, be a one-car family, or maybe a no-car, where you could live without a car. Some of these developments will have car sharing. And again, we're trying to get cars off the road and give people another transit option. So we have a couple of sites we're looking at here, a couple of, we're working on development on, in this area here. There's a couple of developments further east toward Minneapolis. The Shoreham development has been approved, and I think I have a slide. Parkway 25 is undergoing approval, so they would be mixed-use developments, so commercial and residential right in that area. And on this map, you can see the other star to the east is the West Lake. That will be another transit station. It's just less than a mile from Beltline. So we're pretty well served. We're working on getting really good pedestrian connections between those. It's a little bit difficult in a fully built up area. We're working on what we've been calling a joint development site across Beltline from Nordicware, and this is just a concept plan of what it could look like. Again, we would like to build a parking ramp instead of having surface parking at this site, and then we can have office and residential development where, again, when people, you know, can use this without having a car, they can come here or work here or live here. So just wanted to mention, to wrap up, next steps. We're continuing with our planning and engineering designs. We are doing a lot of traffic and roadway planning in the Wooddale corridor because that's a congested corridor at this time, and we want to see what we can do to make it better when the light rail comes, or at least not make it worse, I guess. There's no perfect solution there. I'm working on a number of things. We have a housing strategy. We've done bicycle studies. We're looking at the landscaping along the corridor. A whole number of things that we're doing right now. And we're hoping that it will open in 2020. Thank you.
Larson O'Neil. She is a resident of 19 years who has served 3 years on the Environment and Sustainability Commission. Cindy works for a local solar installation company and has been one of the commission leaders in jumpstarting the program called Partners in Energy that she is here to tell you more about. Please welcome Cindy.
Thank you. Wow, I'm just so excited about St. Louis Park and being here today and hearing about all the initiatives. I'm just a super proud resident and I'm happy to talk about energy today. Let's get the, I'm not sure where my slides are. Okay. Yes, exactly. So, to give kind of a broad overview, because it can get a little confusing, Sustainable SLP is the overarching commission on environment and sustainability, and then we have different work groups. This is one of the work groups, which is the energy work group. The energy work group reached out and has partnered with Xcel Energy, and the program is called Partners in Energy. So it's a two-year program that Xcel, it's kind of a new program, and St. Louis Park was the fourth community to sign up. So we're really excited to be on board right at the beginning here. And these are all the people who have been involved for a year now working on this initiative with Xcel. And as you can see, we have residents and we have heavily represented businesses from our community, which you'll see later how why that's so important to have the business is engaged as well. And then we have Center for Environment and Energy and subject matter experts in solar and a variety of energy and architecture firms. So we're really excited to have this team working on this project. The question that's just overall is why are we focusing on energy? And I don't think I have to spend a lot of time on this. Everybody kind of knows where we're headed, and it's not good. The carbon emissions that we want to focus on, this is just a nice graph to show the United States, and then we wanted to drill it down into St. Louis Park. And through our data analysis, we found out that St. Louis Park actually is higher than the national average. So that's a little discouraging, but it gives us excitement and initiative to move forward in our community. So here's kind of the timeline of the Partners in Energy work. We started in 2014 and signed up with Excel. We recruited our members, and then we have had 5 planning workshops with all these people, and we've created a vision, and then we actually created focus areas where we decided we wanted to spend time working, and which would be the most high leverage work and outcomes. And we are almost ready with the energy action plan, which next will go to the sustainable SLP for approval, and then it'll go to the city council for approval. So just to kind of recap, the Partners in Energy program is supporting the top goals for sustainable SLP. And these are the top goals for sustainable SLP. These 3 first items: a climate action plan, a sustainability vision within the comprehensive plan for our city, and then Green Step Cities, which the city has been working on for a long time and accomplishing a lot in that area on sustainability. Within the Partners in Energy focus area, there's 4 areas. Climate Action Plan, which just will be the sustainable SLP Climate Action Plan, will be for our whole city. And Partnership with Youth, Renewable Energy, and Energy Efficiency in Business. These are 4 areas that we wanted to focus on. The first one, Partners in Youth, is just such an amazing group of people. iMatter, which is a nonprofit organization, has partnered with our Roots and Shoots environmental organization at the high school. And they put together a climate inheritance resolution, and also they did a report card on the environment to give the city feedback on how our community is doing. And they presented to the City Hall on March 21st to the City Council. And if you ever want to see something so inspiring, Google the Star Tribune, this article. St. Louis Park gets a B- on Students' Climate Report Card. And play this video, and it shows our youth presenting to the City Council and really showing their passion for the environment. And I think this is really the heart of where we're headed, and it's just so inspiring. So they were really happy to hear from the youth, and the youth will continue to move forward with their initiatives to help with the environment. The Climate Action Plan, we're going to be presenting actually to the City Council on Monday night at 6:30. And if you want to come hear more about the Climate Action Plan and what we want to do next with that, come to City Hall on Monday night. I think we're presenting at 6:30. And it'll have a lot more detail about what this is all about. It's very exciting because it's going to have a very high level and broad overview and long-term goals for the environment for our community. And you'll see that 2 big things which I think are really exciting is what they would like to propose is carbon neutrality by 2040, and then sourcing 100% renewable electricity by 2025 for our city, and we think that that is possible for our city. So really, really exciting. The third focus area, renewable energy, we'll be focusing on helping people learn and utilize renewable energy resources. So we'll be talking about rooftop solar, community solar, signing up for wind source, which we heard a little bit about this morning too. So there are ways to be renewable right now with wind source, and then we will be learning about community solar for businesses and for residents to sign up for as time goes forward and we're taking on those new opportunities. The final focus area, energy efficiency in business, and getting back to why we had so many business representatives on Partner in Energy, you can see that in the city of St. Louis Park, 70% of the electricity usage is by commercial industrial. So we want the business community engaged and involved, and really this is a big area to get into and support them in their transformation to energy efficiency and renewable energy. And there are a ton of resources out there and we all want to work together to you know, help the businesses move towards goals in this area. This is just a slide that helps see where if we stayed business as usual, our emissions would continue up this way, and this is our proposed goal for the city of St. Louis Park. This is a really interesting slide because it helps you see how we might be able to get there. Our hope is to get to net zero electricity by 2025. We think we can do that by the wind and solar options that are out there if we work in that area. And then the final chunks of carbon emissions that are come from transportation, natural gas, we hope to offset those. So that's the general overall plan. We want to invite everybody to come and help create the future. The Energy Action Plan will have lots of detailed activities for people. We want ideas and people to come and help us and work with us. And we would love to reach out and help this plan move forward with everybody's involvement. Shannon would be a contact person for connecting with us. And then we'll do questions at the end. Thank you so much.
The Solid Waste Program Coordinator for the City of St. Louis Park. Kayla assists in planning, coordinating, implementing, and maintaining administrative activities within the division. So that's a lot of stuff. Kayla is responsible for solid waste, composting and recycling program, and project management, contract development, and communication and marketing for the related programs. So please welcome Kayla.
Thank you, Laura. Again, thanks for having me here. I'm excited to talk to you guys about the city's organics recycling program, which really is an exciting program. It's something that not all communities throughout the Twin Cities metro area have access to. So we're pretty proud of it here in St. Louis Park. So for the most part, I want to speak to you about the organics program, what it is, and talk to you about some ways that we're trying to promote organics in neighborhoods and how important our neighborhoods and just the community aspect of St. Louis Park is in influencing participation, and then talk about some ways to be involved. So, like so many things that we're doing here in the city, the organics program really relies on the leadership and the vision that our city leaders have. And one of the visions that the city has is to be an environmental leader in all of those areas. And so back in about 2010, we did some research and looked at what's actually going into the garbage that our residents are putting out at the curb, and that's after recycling. And we found that, surprisingly enough, there's still some recyclables in the garbage that people are throwing away, so there's room for improvement there. But one really interesting fact is that about 40% of what's actually being thrown away at the curb is organic material that could be diverted. So instead of going to the incinerator, it can be delivered off-site to a commercial composting facility and be composted and made into high-quality, usable compost that can be used throughout our community. So that data, and then researching around the country and looking at other communities that are environmental leaders and seeing that this is one of many things that they're doing to be sustainable cities throughout the United States. Those things all sort of added up, and City Council really felt like organics recycling was something that we needed to pursue as a city. So organics recycling has been around since 2013, and this audience, I suppose I'm preaching to the choir a little bit, but when I go out and talk to other community groups, I have to remember that not everyone is getting really excited when you start talking about organics recycling. And it helps to just understand exactly what it is and why it's so important. So the fact that our organics recycling program is a curbside program that our residents have access to just makes it very convenient because, let's face it, some people just don't have the time or maybe the means to do backyard composting. So organics recycling provides that option for food scraps, paper like napkins and fiber egg cartons to go to be collected curbside. And then there's items that you can include in there's items that you can include in organics recycling that you can't include in a backyard composting bin. So our residents are able to include things like meat, bones, and dairy products in their organics recycling. Those things you couldn't put in a backyard bin, but because our organics are delivered to a commercial composting facility that's just south of Rosemont, the process that they go through to compost that material allows them to go through this involved process to reduce pathogens. The compost pile is actually heated up to a certain temperature, and that lasts for a long enough time to kill any bacteria, break down the dairy, meat, and bones, things that just wouldn't break down in a backyard compost bin. So our organics recycling program is an opt-in program, and all of our curbside customers have access to the program. You just have to opt in. It's a $10 per quarter fee, and that provides the brown lidded cart that hopefully you've seen out in your neighborhood, and a year's supply of compostable bags, and that's picked up weekly. One of the things that people often talk to us about their hesitancy in doing organics recycling is, will it smell? And we remind people that it's the same stuff that you've been throwing away in your garbage, so it's not really going to smell any differently. And we also have some tips on how you can, you know, reduce the chance that odors would occur. So we encourage you to sign up if you haven't already, and we'll have some more information on where and how you can do that at the end. I think that this map is just a great depiction of our participation in St. Louis Park. Right now we're at about 13% participation, and the bottom list of the top five neighborhoods that are top five participating neighborhoods are at the bottom there: Crestview, Westwood Hills, Lake Forest, Creekside, and Fern Hill. So we presented this map to some of the neighborhoods at a neighborhood leadership forum, and are really trying to encourage neighborhoods that don't see their neighborhood name on that top five list to get out and be talking to their neighbors about organics recycling. The reason why we'd like to see higher participation in organics recycling is because then we can see that decrease in organic material that's ending up in the trash. So there's goals that we have at the city level, but there's also goals at the county and state levels to reduce waste and increase recycling. You can see at the city level, we have some participation goals that we'd like to meet by this summer and by next year. The county has a goal of a 6% organics recycling rate for 2015, and they'll be releasing their report on the 2015 recycling rates sometime this month. And then there's also the goal for combined recycling and organics to be at 75% by 2030. And we really need organics to be part of the solution there because of the amount of organics that are currently being thrown away. So we invite people to talk to their neighbors to get involved. If you're already involved in organics recycling, or even if you're doing backyard composting and you just want to promote these options to your neighbors, we have speakers, myself and Emily Barker, who's our solid waste program specialist, who are available to come out to your neighborhood meetings, Boy Scout, Girl Scout meetings, to just talk to people and help them understand what organics recycling is and how they can sign up. And we have a table down in the exhibit hall, so you can sign up today or you can go online to sign up for organics recycling on our website as well. Thanks so much. Jim Vaughan. Jim Vaughan is the Natural Resources Coordinator for the City of St. Louis Park. Jim coordinates and assists in planning and implementing policies and programs intended to manage, preserve, and enhance the city's natural resources. Jim is responsible for administering environmental programs in the areas of development, public education, and pest and wildlife. Pest, wildlife management, natural resources, forestry, community gardening, and other related areas. Please welcome Jim.
Thank you, Laura. Thanks for coming. It's a pleasure to talk about a subject that is going to be very public, I guess you should say, especially in St. Louis Park in the next few years and around the metro area and the state. I'm going to focus on emerald ash borer management in St. Louis Park. And it's an issue that is important because trees, you know, urban trees provide so much. We have about 15,000 boulevard trees in St. Louis Park and probably 75,000 trees in our parks and wooded areas. And then on private property, we have a number of thousands and thousands of trees too, probably about 50,000 trees. So you add all those things up and they do a lot of good things for the environment. They are superheroes. They are part of our infrastructure. People don't realize that, but they are. And they do all kinds of things. And so when we're starting to remove mature trees, that's a lot of canopy that we're losing. That's a lot of water that could be diverted or sucked up by the roots that's going to be running down the drains. A lot of they cool cities down. There's all kinds of good things that the trees do. So, and then also you can quantitate it and put a value on it, the costs of trees and what they will actually provide for us. When a mature tree over 15 inches will start producing those kinds of, well, 17 inches, those kinds of benefits. So people don't realize that all these things that trees are doing. Emerald ash borer came in about 1999 in the port of Detroit, and came in some wood crating. All the wood crates that are shipped into the United States are supposed to be treated with pesticides, and obviously these weren't. And they took the product out of the crates and left the crates at the port, and The emerald ash borer that was in there hatched. They went to nearby ash trees, primarily green ash, are the ones that are most common around here and in the East Coast. And then they started multiplying and killing trees. So they have had a really tough time in the eastern part of the United States, and it's moved west into Minnesota. You can see all the little red dots. If you can see those, Those are all the positive finds with Emerald Ash Borer. And the interesting thing is that a lot of these will actually be, if you put the rail corridor, the transit corridors on here, a lot of them follow the transit corridors, the major thoroughfares, major highways. People are, and we're the biggest culprits in terms of transmitting and moving Emerald Ash Borer from site to site. They see a dead tree, they cut it down, they break it into firewood, and then they give it to their neighbors, bring it up to the cabin, bring it to the campground, and that's how it's been spread most of the time. Emerald Ash Borer itself can only fly about a mile or two as an adult, so it is not what it could be. So this is all the high risk, and we're right here. Obviously, this has been decimated. All the ash, millions of ash trees in those areas are already gone. So they have just plain areas with nothing on them. And it's going to probably happen. This is in Wisconsin. And you can see here, I'll just do a little, this is it here. And then you can see the, in here. And then look where the arrows are again. You can kind of see where the ash pockets were in this woods, just as one example. And if you don't know if you have an ash, be sure to contact my office and we'd be happy to identify your trees on your lot. We do it as a free service. We'll make house calls to identify diseases, give you diagnoses on plants or trees that you have issues with as well. So these are the biggest ash components that we have in St. Louis Park, primarily again green ash, but we do have black and white. Minnesota has the highest population of ash in the lower 48. And so we're really nervous as a state with Emerald Ash Borer. We have a lot of black ash. Those are found in the swampy areas of the central and north central Minnesota. And we have about a billion ash trees in Minnesota, so a lot of us are going to be hit by it. Emerald Ash Borer, I get a lot of calls, and which one is Emerald Ash Borer? Well, it's not the cicada. That's that buzzing one you hear at the end in fall, you know, the zzz. But they're really large, too. The Emerald Ash Borer is actually quite small. It's, about a quarter inch in length. And it's very pretty, that's the problem. Very pretty, but it does some devastation. Here's the life cycle of it real quick. And the most damaging part of the life cycle is right here. This is the thing that actually will, the adult female will actually lay the eggs underneath the bark. The eggs will hatch into larva, and as the larva grow, they're eating the cambium of the tree. And that ends up killing it. So you get thousands and thousands of these in a tree, and they're killing the water and the mineral conducting, food conducting system of the tree, and so the tree ends up dying. And when ash die, they die fast and they break apart really fast. So we have a lot of ash dying all at once, which we've seen in the East Coast. They all tend to die all at once because you can't find it. It's really hard, and it's an insidious insect to figure out if the tree actually has it. So oftentimes it's been in the tree for 3-5 years. And then all at once, all the surrounding trees have it too, and they all end up dying at the same time. And then they'll start breaking apart within a year. Ash will crumble and break apart, which is not a very good thing either because of power lines, backyards. In St. Louis Park, we have small lots and large trees, so you can see where the problem could arise. Well, what we've been trained to look for is woodpecker damage. So if you have an ash tree, see if you have woodpeckers, primarily in the winters when we really see it because you have the leaves off it, but they will actually poke around and try to find those little galleries. This little guy, after it gets nice and big and juicy, then they'll actually somehow, namely, the woodpeckers know where they are, and they will peck at it, and they pull them out. Unfortunately, we don't have enough woodpeckers to sustain eating all of the emerald ash borer that are produced. So, but that's a good sign that you see, especially on the south side of the trees, the emerald ash borer will lay it on the warm side of the tree first, their eggs, and then they'll hatch from there. That's where you typically see the woodpecker damage. St. Louis Park, we did a survey in 2010 of all our ash trees on the boulevards in our parks. We have about 2,300 total, and we have been successively removing some. We have a plan where we're actually removing some, planting trees. We're going to be doing a few other things I'll talk about in just a moment. But you can see we rated up by how great a condition they were. So the number ones were actually the worst condition, two, the next worst, and so on. So we've been chopping away at that, no pun intended. And then we're going to actually try to preserve some of these while some of the smaller trees that are being replaced actually get some size in them. So here are some of the plan elements that I spoke of. And these are all the things that we're doing right now to manage that emerald ash borer. We do not have it in St. Louis Park. The closest to the find was in Lakewood Cemetery, if you know where that is, on the east side of Calhoun, Lake Calhoun. It's also been found along the Mississippi River pretty much in the whole corridor of Minneapolis right now. So Minneapolis has a number of spots besides the river. St. Paul has had a huge outbreak this year as well, and then a number of other cities have experienced in the metro. But I'm expecting we'll probably find a Rossburg this year in St. Louis Park. We've had a few scares and we've had a few tests, but we've never found the actual insect yet. So we're doing all of these different things to try to combat emerald ash. We're removing about 75 trees a year. We've removed over 500 trees since 2010. Ash trees, these are the ones that have been sliced in half by Xcel Energy that are under power lines or they're not doing very well, stressed out. So those are the ones we're removing, and then we're replacing them with a variety and a diversity of different trees. And you can see, being proactive, we're right about here in the metro area. So we were thinking got a couple of years left before it will exponentially grow, and then we will have big trouble for a lot of the metro areas. In St. Louis Park, we have about 18% of our ash trees on the public property and about four times that on private property. So there's a higher percent, or it's about the same percent, but there are many more, four times as many ash trees on the private property as there are on public. Some cities have 50% ash trees. When they have Dutch elms these days, we still have Dutch elm too, by the way, but when the elms were removed, a lot of people, a lot of cities planted ash trees because they grew well and they stuck them in the ground. You didn't really have to do much to them, low maintenance. So unfortunately, some cities didn't learn the lesson from Dutch elm disease and overplanted those, and now they will be paying for those in many ways. And so we're trying to slow the ash mortality down. It's a big strategy that a lot of cities are doing. We're trying to go cross boundaries as well, because the Emerald Ash Board does not know boundaries. So we're trying to work together. We're trying to get a state initiative, get some funding so we can all do some of those tools together and to slow the ash spread down. And no other city, no other state has done the SLAM yet, and we're trying to do that in Minnesota. So we're going to start an injection program this year. I showed you the high quality, high conditioned ash trees. We have about 500 plus, actually probably a lot more than that, but we're going to start with about 300 trees we're going to inject this year on the boulevards and in our parks, and then we're going to do another 300 next year. With the injection, they last for 2 years, the cycle, and it actually is an insecticide that will kill any of the emerald ash borer in contact. So they eat a leaf, they die. If they lay the eggs in the bark, they'll end up dying. So it's very effective, it works really well, and it's a trunk injection, so there's no sprays or anything. And you do it when the tree is fully leafed out, so it has to suck up the chemical as it's injected around the roots or around the trunk of the base of the tree, and then it goes throughout the whole tree, called the systemic insecticide. And we are offering it to homeowners too. We have a wholesale price. We've gotten Rainbow Tree as our contractor for this program, so we will be publicizing and promoting this program. Very shortly you'll hear about that. And then we are also, in conjunction with that, we've had our tree sale. This is our ninth year in our tree sale. The idea is that we want people to buy these trees. There's $35. It's a subsidy from the city. We're subsidizing the cost. And we have about six or eight different varieties. Idea is to diversify our canopy here, so you can plant on your own yard. Why, if you still have an ash tree, it doesn't have emerald ash borer, but it could if it doesn't, and it will if you don't inject it, it'll end up dying. So we're trying to get the new growth going before the old ends up going away. Tree Trust is our partner, and they were the ones they have a booth downstairs, and you can certainly order right here if you're interested. They have a computer set up. You order the trees in advance. Our distribution day is May 7th at our maintenance shop. We have a variety of trees that we do plant. I have these lists online as well for people if you're interested in figuring out which trees to plant. And then these are, I mentioned it, the countywide, the statewide. I'm president of our State Urban Forest Council. I've been down to the legislature a number of times trying to push this initiative, because I think a lot of people are thinking that it's gone away and it's just beginning, unfortunately. So with that, thank you.
So as you know, I recruit volunteers for the city of St. Louis Park, and on Earth Day, which is April 22nd, Beautify the Park is kicking off. It's when school groups, businesses, and residents, individuals head out and pick up litter now that all the snow has melted. They pick up litter in the parks, along the frontage roads where a lot of garbage collects, and it's my goal to have every park and dirty area in St. Louis Park get picked up. So if you want to take part, feel free to reach out to me. My name is Laura Smith, and you can find my information on the city's website. I also am recruiting for a more longer-term volunteer opportunity, which is adopt a park, adopt a garden, and adopt a spot. So the first two are pretty self-explanatory. It would be adopt a park is heading out to the park at least one time a month, check for damage, pick up litter. Adopt a park or adopt a garden would be helping to plant one of our park garden beds and then managing that throughout the summer. And then adopt a spot is a new one, and that really is to pick any public city-owned space. And if it's an area that's near your house that tends to get a lot of litter, you can adopt that spot. We've had people adopt storm drains. We've had people adopt intersections, parts of trails that run underneath a bridge where a lot of trash collects. So that's been popular too. So feel free to reach out. I also have a booth downstairs. So, who has questions for the panel? Anyone?
No, I think I'll be fine.
Okay.
Yeah, I wanted to ask about compost for condo buildings. So we got all excited about composting, but I don't think it works for a condo building yet. But it's going to, is that right?
That's a great question. And I mentioned the city's organics program is available to any resident that's already receiving curbside garbage and recycling service from the city. So in the case of a condo or even an apartment, someplace where you have property management or an association that's contracting for garbage and recycling service, then you would need to work with your condo association to see if the hauler that you're currently using would provide organics recycling. The city uses a contracted hauler for collecting the organics throughout the city, but a number of haulers throughout Hennepin County also collect organics, and we can connect you with the right kind of resources to be able to get the information before your association, if that's the case, and help you in that way. Hennepin County also provides a lot of great resources for condos and apartments and multi-unit buildings, so that you have signs and access to bins in some cases through grant programs, but the signs and labels are free of charge.
So would somebody like you, or maybe you, come and speak to our condo association and tell us how we might go about it?
Sure, we can certainly do that.
And we'd start.
Yes.
Okay, I'll call you.
Stop by my booth or follow me out on the way out, and we can get a card and get you the information you need.
A question for Mr. Vaughan. Is there a federal effort to contain the emerald ash borer? That map you showed looked like one of those zombie movies that kind of spread out. Is the federal government getting involved at all?
Not a lot, no, unfortunately.
The question was, is the federal government helping? There is a one group that deals with invasive species, but they're overwhelmed with all the invasive species that are coming into the United States. So they give grants to cities and to states, some, but we have not received one yet. And so there's money trying to be obtained that way. But other than that, they're not really helping in a coordinated effort. It's unfortunate, but. So we're trying to do that. We're trying to coordinate the whole state, and it's quite an effort to get a lot of communities and a lot of counties to cooperate and kind of see the light on this. So there's, we wish, but there isn't, unfortunately.
Last call for questions.
Well, I hope it's not a silly question, but is there a woodpecker breeding program that could partner with your emerald ash borer program?
Well, I think providing habitat for dead trees, that kind of stuff that aren't ash or elm that would transmit diseases, but by leaving dead trees and woods, that kind of stuff is promoting woodpecker habitat. So I think that would be part of it. we don't have any program. There are a couple other things the state is doing with the help from the federal government a little bit. There's a wasp program that there's these little wasps that will actually lay eggs in the emerald ash borer and will kill it. And so they've been letting those around the metro area, and they let them down in Houston County and Minnesota and a few other states. And that's showing some promise, but it's only reducing it by about 10 or 15% of the population. It's not going to eradicate the entire thing. So they're looking at other biological controls. And where this came from in China, they're looking at some of the trees that are resistant to the ash there as well. So there's some research going on. I guess that's where the federal government is working on that and sort of helping with cities manage it and states. But I like the idea with the woodpecker program, but we haven't gotten to that stage yet, unfortunately.
If you put out information that people need to allow their dead trees, not ash, but their other dead trees, to remain on their property for a while for woodpeckers.
Yeah, that's a little hard though. You know, people get nervous when they have a dead tree that's a couple feet from their house, you know, on a neighbor's property. So that, I don't think we would probably be okay promoting that one. But, you know, some of the city woods where we have, we're minimally managed, we leave a lot of the dead material in there for wildlife purposes.
And then I have a question. With the injections, is there any other adverse effects to any other species or the tree itself? And how long does the duration of that last in the tree?
Yeah, that's a good question. The ash injection is an insecticide, and there are some that are being used. They're called neonicotinoids that have been proven to be, they kill pollinators, particularly bees. They've proven that the ones that we're promoting, the chemical we're using is not that, and the studies have not proven that this particular chemical will harm bees or pollinators. Plus, most of the ash trees are wind. All the ash trees we have in Minnesota are wind pollinated, so they're not really pollinated by bees or butterflies or flies or moths. So, very small percent of trees in Minnesota are pollinated via insects. So we really don't have to worry about that. The chemical itself is contained just in the tree, and it will dissipate as the tree ages and as the chemical ages as well.
I'd also like to note, Jim mentioned the wasp that helps, they eat emerald ash borer or they kill it. There is a table downstairs if you're interested in learning what that wasp looks like. And it's not a aggressive wasp. And you can actually sign up to volunteer through the U of N to watch for that wasp. And you can go out in the community, and if you see it, you can collect the wasp and see if the wasp has emerald ash borer. And sometimes that can be, you can detect emerald ash borer earlier. So there is a booth downstairs from the U of N if you want to check that out too.
Sure. I have a question about the light rail. Now, is the federal government, have they given all of the approval for the money for starting from Minneapolis to Eden Prairie? And is there also some lawsuits that are going to be coming up? Have you heard anything about that?
Okay, yes. So the question is, has the federal government approved all the money, and are there any lawsuits? So the way it typically works, most transit, light rail transit systems around the country work toward getting money from the Federal Transit Administration to cover 50% of the cost of building the line. So we are doing that here, and there's a few more steps to go, but they work hand in hand all the way. So they're wrapping up the environmental work, and that should be done and approved this summer. And then there's another step that will happen in 2017. But the Metropolitan Council works closely all the way to make sure that they have everything in order to do that. So, you know, it's not like our metro area is off on its own and not checking in. They talk to the Federal Transit Administration all the time and make sure they're meeting all their requirements. So that looks good. There have been a couple of lawsuits. I don't know all of the details on all of them. There's been a partial ruling on one that was from the Lincoln Park Alliance in Minneapolis, and there's another one in Minnetonka that I don't believe has been resolved.
that's about the extent of my detailed knowledge on those.
Okay. So officially, it's not going to be, they're not sure if 2020 will actually be the time, or?
That's the schedule now. I mean, it has changed over time.
Okay.
And it could continue to be pushed back a little bit, but that's what everyone is shooting for right now.
Okay. Thank you.
All right. Well, let's give all of our presenters a hand. And thank you all.